It was in July 1943 that the Russian city of Kursk bore witness to the largest tank battle in history. The outcome of the battle was crucial. It put an end to Hitler's offensive power on the Eastern Front. At Kursk, the Soviet army would draw the German forces into a deliberate battle of attrition, designed to grind down Hitler's last remaining attacking strength in the east. The German staff officers could see the danger, but the Fuhrer was blind to it. On the 10th of May 1943, the architect of Germany's tank forces, General Heinz Guderian, became engaged in a heated conversation with Adolf Hitler regarding Hitler's decision to attack at Kursk. Guderian is reported to have asked, "How many people do you think even know where Kursk is? It is a matter of profound indifference to the world whether we hold Kursk or not. Why do we want to attack in the east at all this year?" To this, Hitler replied, "You're quite right. Whenever I think of this attack, my stomach turns over." Guderian strongly advised Hitler to remain on the defensive, but Hitler was determined. He would go ahead with the attack. Guderian was not alone in his apprehension. Almost to a man, Hitler's generals had advised him to adopt a defensive posture on the Eastern Front during 1943. The last 2 years had cost them dearly, and they needed a chance to rest and regroup. Hitler's decision to attack would seriously damage his forces and remove any hope the Germans had of regaining the initiative in the Eastern Theater. By draining away the German tank strength, the short but intensive Battle of Kursk would tip the scales of World War II decisively in the favor of Soviet Russia. On the 1st of September 1939, Hitler's forces smashed through the Polish frontier. This prompted Britain and France to officially declare war on Germany 2 days later. Hitler hoped to avoid this outcome, as he never expected the Western governments to go to war over Poland. Poland was obliterated in a matter of weeks when Hitler used the Blitzkrieg tactic to gain control of the country. Before Hitler could continue advancing eastwards, he knew he would first have to deal with his enemies in the west. By May 1940, the German troops turned their offensive westwards. The war with the west was drastically different to that with Poland, as the forces facing the Germans were modern and well equipped. However, the British and French armies were still relying on tactics used during the First World War, and were totally unprepared for the superior skills and strategy of the Germans. Within weeks, Hitler took control of Holland, Belgium, Luxembourg, and France. The British managed to escape across the Channel at Dunkirk, but were in no position to fight back. Full of confidence after the great victories of 1939 and 1940, Hitler pushed ahead with his plans to invade Soviet Russia in 1941. He held a deep contempt for the Soviet Union and boasted that we just have to kick in the door and the whole rotten edifice will come crashing down. The gains made during the invasion of Russia in June 1941 confirmed Hitler's optimism, as a disorganized and poorly led Red Army retreated in complete confusion. However, the first winter in Russia gave the German soldiers a sharp taste of what lay in store for them. Battered but unbowed, the German forces just managed to avoid total collapse. For the next 18 months, the front lines seesawed back and forth, as both sides wrestled for control of the towns and cities. The southern region in particular saw some of the biggest and most damaging battles for both sides. Ferocious battles for Sevastopol, Kiev, Rostov, and Stalingrad consumed vast amounts of men and materials as control of the towns and cities swayed from side to side. In February 1943, the total defeat at Stalingrad was a disaster for the Germans. But a switch to the strategic defensive might just have brought enough time to regain the initiative in 1944. But Hitler was adamant. He would attack. By mid-1943, the focus of attention would once more be in the south of Russia, where the Germans were to make one more attempt to gain the decisive edge. This was to be the last great gamble in the East, a high noon for Hitler and his hopes for victory. Confident after the stunning victories over Poland in 1939 and the Western Allies in 1940, Hitler pushed ahead with his ultimate goal of defeating Soviet Russia in 1941. His generals had advised him to wait, for German forces were not strong enough at this stage of the war. They needed more time to prepare. Hitler instead mounted the biggest land invasion in history. Like his previous campaigns, Hitler expected quick victory, and the mobile warfare tactic was employed once again. By the winter of 1941, however, it was apparent that the war in Russia would be difficult and take far longer than anticipated. The Russians launched a massive counter-offensive during this first winter and almost succeeded in defeating the Germans. Hitler himself issued the order to stand fast and hold the ground already won. The success of this policy convinced Hitler that he knew better than his generals. But when it was repeated, the policy of holding on was to prove disastrous. The crushing defeat of the German Sixth Army at Stalingrad affected Hitler deeply, as it came as a direct result of his refusal to allow a withdrawal. Now he planned the Kursk offensive to regain the initiative and save his reputation. Unlike Hitler, the ruthless dictator of the USSR had no formal military experience. A politician first and foremost, he was prepared to do almost anything to maintain his position of power. Stalin was responsible for the purges of the Red Army in 1937, which severely hampered their fighting capabilities in the early stages of the German invasion. The loss of so many commanders prevented the Red Army from fighting cohesively. Nevertheless, Stalin knew how to manipulate people and situations to his own advantage. Once the German invasion began, he quickly rallied the population behind him, despite the fact that he had been systematically killing countless numbers of his own people. He played on their love of Mother Russia, and even within the army, he ensured that the power of the political commissars was limited during these crucial early stages. He was astute enough, however, to listen to his generals and took their advice many times. He put the brilliance of commanders like Zhukov and Konev to good use, playing one against the other to ensure maximum results. Quick to take the glory for any successes, and ruthless enough to ensure his troops and people would not dare to question him, he saw his nation through to ultimate victory over the Nazi invaders. By the spring of 1943, the German army and German nation were still in deep shock over the defeat at Stalingrad. This defeat was their first major reverse of the war, and the famed tenacity of the Russian soldier had been decisively proved. The Russian offensive, launched immediately after Stalingrad, presented the very real danger that the German army would be pushed back even further. Fast reactions from von Manstein and the effective use of the fighting capabilities of the German armed forces finally halted the Russian attack. The stunning victory at Kharkov, achieved against the odds, became known as von Manstein's miracle. The desperate men of Army Group South had at last contained the Soviet advance. Further north, Army Group Center had held fast and halted the Russian advances near Orel. In between these two areas, the Soviet advances had created a huge enemy bulge, which held large amounts of Soviet men and materials. In the middle of the bulge lay the town of Kursk. Keen to capitalize on the victory at Kharkov, Hitler wanted to regain the initiative in the east. Von Manstein drew up a plan that provided for a similar action to Kharkov, where the German army had first given up ground and had then quickly counterattacked when the Russian lines of supply became overstretched. Characteristically, Hitler rejected the withdrawal phase of the plan, but approved the attacks towards Kursk. This part of the plan was developed by Colonel General Zeitzler, who gave it the final draft, codenamed Citadel. The plan was to advance from the north and south towards Kursk and trap the Soviets in a huge pocket. This pocket could then be systematically destroyed. To make the plan work, however, the attack would have to be launched quickly before the Russians had time to prepare defenses. The initial plan had May as the start date, but various delays forced the start date back to July, by which time the Russians had prepared defensive positions that would present the Germans with formidable obstacles. The Russian victory at Stalingrad had shown that the mighty German army could be defeated. The seemingly endless resources of Russia in both men and machines could and would be sacrificed to ensure the ultimate goal was achieved. The Russian offensive launched after Stalingrad had been intended to build on the recent successes, but what was not expected was the ability of the German soldier to recover quickly. The Russians suffered a surprise defeat at Kharkov in March 1943, just 1 month after the surrender at Stalingrad. Stalin was keen to advance further, but Zhukov and others persuaded Stalin that a defensive posture was more suitable at this stage of the war. The Russians were also fully aware of the German plans, as they had been receiving information from the Lucy spy ring. This reliable source was fed from Bletchley Park in England. The scientists working at this top secret location had broken the secret German Enigma code at the start of the war, and had been watching developments very closely ever since. They passed information to the Soviets via an intricate web of contacts situated in Switzerland. Although the Russians never knew the true source of the information, they came to rely upon its accuracy. They were therefore given the dates of the planned German attacks in advance and began to prepare accordingly. massive defensive belts were constructed, with the sole purpose of the destruction of German armor and men. Zhukov, the master tactician, also gathered strong reserves that would be unleashed when the time was right. This well-prepared trap would be the launch pad for the defeat of Germany in the east. Georgi Zhukov gained his first military experience under the Tsarist army during World War I. He actually changed sides during the war and joined the communists during the revolution in 1917. Zhukov served in various positions after the war and became an early expert in the use of armor. He managed to escape the purges of 1937 that cost so many their lives. His first real success came against Japan at Khalkhin Gol during 1939, and he then played his part in the successful defense of Leningrad. He was given the responsibility for the defense of Stalingrad in late 1942, when he planned and executed the first major defeat of the German army. Zhukov was a quick-tempered man who intensely disliked those who failed in their duty. Konstantin Rokossovsky was one of the Soviet advisors during the Spanish Civil War. He was also caught up in the purges of 1937. He escaped death, but did spend a period in prison. He was called back into service to help in the defense of Moscow in 1941, and also had the control of the Don Front during the Stalingrad Battle. He was in command of the Central Front during the Battle of Kursk. Pavel Rotmistrov was also an early advocate of tank warfare. He first had command of the Russian 7th Tank Corps and was involved in the fighting around Rostov and Stalingrad, where he formed his tactical ideas. It was Rotmistrov who first suggested the use of complete armor-only formations. This tactic was adopted, and he subsequently gained command of the 5th Guards Tank Army. A very able commander, Rotmistrov had the appearance of a quiet schoolteacher, but the mind and determination of a brilliant military tactician. Ivan Konev, born in 1897, served the Tsar during the First World War as an NCO. By 1917, he had become a communist and joined the Russian Revolution, serving as a political commissar. He then joined the Red Army and graduated successfully from the Frunze Military Academy. In August 1941, he served in the Transcaucasian Military District inside the Smolensk sector. In October 1941, he became commander of the Kalinin Front and helped to resist the German drive towards Moscow. Konev made a name for himself as an aggressive and highly competent commander, regarded by many as second only to Zhukov. He was the perfect man to command the steppe front during the Kursk offensive. Kurt Zeitzler served as an infantryman during World War I and continued his military career during the interwar years. In 1934, he transferred to the newly created tank section, which was one of a number of changes brought in under Hitler. By 1939, he had risen to the rank of colonel, his forte being organization and mechanized warfare. He held various staff positions during the first 2 years of the war, and by 1942, he was serving in the West under von Rundstedt. He played a significant role in the Allied defeat at Dieppe during that year, bringing him to the attention of Hitler. A month after Dieppe, he was promoted to general and became the chief of staff. His approach to older generals sometimes caused him problems with fellow officers, for he always spoke his mind, even clashing with Hitler on a number of occasions. He tried in vain to make Hitler see sense at Stalingrad. It was Zeitzler who drew up the plans for the Kursk offensive and its pincer attacks. Although some of the other generals voiced their concerns, Zeitzler pushed enthusiastically for the plan, which was finally approved by Hitler. Its consequences would prove disastrous for Germany. Erich von Manstein, the commander of Army Group South, is acknowledged as one of the most able German commanders of the Second World War. His military experience dated back to World War I, where he fought on the Western and Eastern fronts. Before the end of the war, he had reached the rank of captain. By the time Hitler came to power in 1933, von Manstein was a lieutenant colonel with the German General Staff. Further promotions followed until the outbreak of World War II, when he held the rank of lieutenant general. Before the start of the war, he had been responsible for suggesting the use of the assault gun that was to become known as the Sturmgeschütz, a machine that was to play a significant part in Germany's conduct of the war. He was closely involved in planning the various opening campaigns. The successful plan for the attacks in the West in 1940 are also thought to be the brainchild of von Manstein, although Hitler later claimed them as his own. Von Manstein had a gift for determining the enemy's intentions and identifying their weaknesses. He held various field commands from the start of the war with Russia in 1941, and successes included the defeat of the fortress of Sevastopol. However, the longer the war in Russia dragged on, the more Hitler and von Manstein differed over its execution. Hitler was obsessed with holding positions to the last man, and von Manstein tried in vain to change Hitler's tactical reasoning. By the start of July 1943, von Manstein was in overall command of Army Group South, which played the major role in the execution of Plan Citadel. Hermann Hoth, born on the 12th of April 1895, served in the First World War. He remained in the German army, and by 1936, Hoth was a divisional commander. He commanded the 15th Panzer Corps during the invasion of Poland, and on the 27th of October 1939, was awarded with the Ritterkreuz for his service. Hoth went on to lead the 15th Panzer Corps through the successful French campaign of 1940. He then led Panzer Group 3, later renamed the 3rd Panzer Army, towards Leningrad and on to Moscow, where he almost succeeded in his mission. By 1942, Hoth was commander of the 4th Panzer Army and in action at Stalingrad. His mission was to get the trapped 6th Army out of the city, but the task was virtually impossible, and he failed. Hoth and his 4th Panzer Army went on to be involved at the heart of fighting at Kursk. Army Group Center under von Kluge also played a significant role in the plans for Kursk. To the north of the salient, von Kluge's army group would serve in the 9th Army that would provide one of the two great pincers designed to snuff out the Soviet salient. Walter Model also gained his early experiences during World War I, attaining the rank of captain. Like von Manstein, he had served in the interwar German army in various staff and field postings, including a stint as a lecturer on tactics and history. He continued in various posts in the early stages of World War II, and by mid-1940 held the rank of lieutenant general when he was also given command of the 3rd Panzer Division. Although he was an infantryman through and through, he quickly made it his job to explore the potential of tank warfare. Model constantly visited the front lines and always took a keen interest in the welfare of his men. His division was involved in the titanic encirclement at Kiev and also the attacks towards Moscow. Model firmly believed in the concept of lightning war, and his successes did not go unnoticed by Hitler. By the start of 1942, he was in command of the 9th Army with the rank of Colonel General he was given the task of attacking in the Rzhev sector in southern Russia. The bloody battles here would last for almost a year. By spring 1943, his 9th Army was well placed to take part in the Kursk offensive. Hitler knew just how vital the coming battle would be and placed a great deal of faith in the new tanks developed for the offensive. General Heinz Guderian had been recalled and appointed to a new position of Inspector General of the Armored Forces, especially for the Kursk battle. The purges of 1937 upon the army by Stalin had left a weak and poorly led force. Around the start of 1941, however, the army was undergoing a reorganization. When the Germans launched their attack in June of that year, they caught the Red Army off guard. The initial advances by the Germans cut deep into the Russian rear areas. In many cases, the Germans found themselves advancing eastwards and also defending westwards as the retreating Russians caught up with them. There appeared to be no effective organization or control over the mass of Russian soldiers in the early stages. As the first winter set in, however, the first signs appeared that things were not going to go Hitler's way. Better adapted to the climate and countryside, the Russian army quickly launched their first offensive that almost succeeded in overrunning the German army. The main drawback for the Red Army was the constant interference by political commissars who instilled fear into every soldier. Often, commanders were reluctant to take key decisions without clear instructions from much higher up. This directly affected the course of the fighting and may have contributed to some of the Red Army's defeats. The Russian soldier was also dealing with new tactics being employed by the Germans. What was more, the Red Army suffered many problems of supply, and the loss of vital industrial regions and the relocation of factories further east hit production hard. As the war progressed, the Red Army became better equipped and more able to cope with the superior skills of the German army. The Red Army's sheer weight of numbers, of both men and materials, was beginning to turn the tide in their favor by mid-1943. The Russian soldier had the backup of plentiful tanks and planes, and they did not appear in the bewildering array of different types used by the German army. The most widely used battle tank was the T-34. This tank made its battlefield debut in 1941, soon after the Germans poured over the Russian border. The Germans had no prior knowledge of the T-34, and they quickly learned to respect it. The T-34's design, which remained largely unchanged throughout the war, was simple and crude, but highly practical. It had excellent sloping armor, which, although only 45 millimeters thick, increased its protective capabilities. It had wide tracks that were well suited to the Russian countryside and the worst of the Russian winter. The armaments on the version used at Kursk were a 76 millimeter dual-purpose main gun backed up with three 7.62mm machine guns. It was powered by a very reliable diesel engine and gave a top speed of 33 miles per hour. It weighed around 26 tons and had a five-man crew. The downside was the poorly designed turret that had to be traversed by hand. It was also very cramped, with rudimentary radio communications. Fighting alongside the T-34 was the KV-1. This was a heavier tank, weighing in at over 43 tons, which also had a 5-man crew. The reliable diesel engine produced a top speed of 22 miles per hour. The armor protection was 110 millimeters thick, and like the T-34, its main gun was a 76 millimeter weapon, backed up with three 7.62 millimeter machine guns. It carried more than adequate ammunition supplies and had excellent suspension. Unfortunately, it also had a poorly designed turret and complex gun sighting mechanism. The crews that manned them were poorly trained, and these faults conspired to ensure that the KV-1 would never have the impact of its more famous stablemate. Kursk is famed for its large tank battle, but equally as ferocious was the aerial war that raged overhead. Like their tank forces, the Russians used a few simple designs for their aircraft that were practical and produced in large numbers. The IL-2 was one of these. It would see a great deal of action around Kursk. Over 36,000 of these aircraft were manufactured before the end of the war. The IL-2 was a ground attack plane and was an excellent performer at low levels. Top speed was around 250 miles per hour. The main armaments were two 37mm cannons and two 7.62mm machine guns, plus one rear-facing machine gun for added protection. It could also carry up to 600 kilograms of bombs. As it was best suited to low-level attacks, the construction allowed for a certain amount of armor protection to be included. The main areas protected were the underside, cockpit, and fuel tanks. From its introduction in 1941, the plane was involved in most of the fighting on the Eastern Front. Although the Red Air Force pilots could not match the skills of the Luftwaffe aces, this plane and its pilots did play a significant part in the defeat of the Third Reich. The Nazi propaganda machine had described the Russians as subhuman. The German army advanced into Russia with the belief that they were up against an incapable army, poorly led and badly equipped. The first 6 months of the war produced evidence that this was indeed the case. However, as 1942 began, the Red Army started to show its true abilities. Its men were able to cope with the extreme weather fluctuations, sustaining themselves on meager rations and living off the land. They had excellent defensive skills, something that the Germans quickly learned to their cost. They also had simple but highly effective equipment that was designed for the punishing weather. The Russian Achilles heel was their poor leadership and fear of their political masters. The tactics employed paid no heed to the cost in human lives, and penal squads and summary executions were widely used in an attempt to gain objectives. The overriding motivation of many of the men was their love of Mother Russia. Despite all of the hardships and demands placed upon them, their resilience and determination would see them through to victory. The German army of World War II was arguably one of the most efficient the modern world has seen. Superbly led by capable leaders such as Guderian, Rommel, Model, and von Manstein, they achieved victory after victory in the first years of the war. The army was extremely professional and very aggressive. Expert training saw the Wehrmacht employ new and far-thinking tactics with devastating results. These tactics helped them defeat numerically superior enemy forces and secure almost impossible objectives. For 2 years, their combined tactics and training would take them from Poland to the shores of France and then on to the banks of the Volga at Stalingrad, defeating every enemy along the way. A major problem was that the Wehrmacht had to contend with incessant infighting at higher levels. This sometimes resulted in unclear objectives, most notably during the war with Russia. Without doubt, being led by a dictator such as Hitler, whose military experience and abilities were limited, also had its effect on the final outcome of the war. Masters at the art of counterattack and equally adept in attack or defense, the German army was, however, a worthy opponent to any foe. Despite an ever-decreasing supply of resources and multiplying difficulties, they remained resolute and focused on their tasks. The heavy defeat at Stalingrad had deeply affected them, and the fact that they quickly recovered and managed a stunning victory at Kharkov is evidence of their capabilities. Contrary to popular belief, by the start of July 1943, the German army was far from defeated. The arrival of the formidable T-34 onto the battlefield caused the Germans to revive some of their pre-war plans for heavier tanks. One of the results was arguably the best tank of World War II. The Panzer Mark V, or Panther, weighed in at 45 tons. It had a five-man crew protected by 120mm sloped armor. This tank was armed with a superb 75mm L-70 main gun with two 7.92mm MG-34 machine guns as backup. It could produce a top speed of 30 miles per hour. It was rushed through production to ensure that it was ready for the Kursk offensive. Hitler placed great hopes on the Panther and delayed the start of the battle to allow for its production. The early models were plagued with mechanical breakdowns that would have serious consequences for the troops at Kursk. But once the design problems were rectified, the Panther tank became an excellent weapon. The Panzer Mark VI, better known as the Tiger I, was designed to put the Germans ahead of the Russians in tank design. The result was a machine that weighed in at a huge 55 tons. Its five-man crew was well protected by 110mm thick armor. Unlike the Panther, the Tiger I had the more conventional flat-sided armor that wasn't as effective as sloped armor, but it was so thick that it was virtually impervious to any weapon on the battlefield. The Tiger's main armament was the phenomenal 88mm gun, capable of destroying anything it came across at ranges up to 2,000 meters. The close support weapons were the standard two MG-34 machine guns. The 21-liter engine produced a top speed of 24 miles per hour. The first large-scale deployment of the Tiger tank was at Kursk, when approximately 100 were used. They were placed mainly with the elite formations of the Waffen-SS and the Gross Deutschland Division. The Tiger would quickly earn a fearsome reputation and would play its part in helping the Germans smash through the extensive Russian defenses during Citadel. This heavy tank destroyer appeared after Ferdinand Porsche's design for the Tiger I was turned down. The Porsche firm was so confident that their design would be chosen that they had begun to produce their version, but production stopped when Hitler's decision was announced. Rather than waste those that had already been constructed, they were put to use. Hitler had also ordered the design of an assault weapon that could mount the longer L-71 version of the 88mm gun. The Tiger I was incapable of doing this, so the 90 Porsche chassis were chosen. The resulting weapon, Ferdinand, weighed in at a colossal 68 tons and required a crew of 6 men. The armor protection was provided by 200 millimeters of steel plate. The top speed was only 12 miles per hour. The Ferdinand was rushed through the production stage with very serious consequences for the crews manning them and the infantry who were relying on them during the fighting. During the design stage, the need for a close-quarter defense machine gun was overlooked. The suspension was not adequate to support the weight of the tank destroyer, with the result that the vehicle easily bogged down. These flaws helped to ensure that the battlefield debut of the Ferdinand was a failure. 40 of the 80 machines which took part in the battle were lost to the enemy within the first 3 days. One other important new development made its arrival known during the Kursk offensive. The Stuka dive bomber had played its part in the early victories of the German army. It became an excellent psychological weapon and instilled terror again and again. However, as the war progressed, this slow aircraft was quickly outclassed by the faster enemy planes. The Stuka had undergone a few modifications since its first introduction in 1937. The standard version, available in early 1943, could reach a speed of around 255 miles per hour. The armament was two 7.92mm machine guns situated on the wings with a further rear-facing machine gun. It could carry up to 1,800 kilograms of bombs. The Stuka was widely used, and during March of 1943, testing took place on a new anti-tank version. Two 37mm flak cannons were fitted to the underside of the plane in place of the bomb load. It was soon found that this weapon was very accurate and effective for destroying enemy tanks, although the pilots had to go into a shallow dive and get within close range of their targets, making them vulnerable to anti-aircraft fire. The use of this new weapon became the responsibility of some of Germany's best-known pilots, among them Hans Ulrich Rudel, an accomplished airman who held Germany's highest award for bravery. Rudel, and the pilots like him, put the new tank-busting variant to good use and quickly chalked up a high number of enemy tank kills. The restrictions imposed on Germany after the First World War included a limit on the size of her army. Although painful for the Germans, this restriction would have noticeable benefits when war finally broke out again. The selection process was rigorous, and only the best candidates were chosen. As the political situation changed and the army expanded, these carefully chosen men moved up the ranks and passed their skills down to many others. Another result of the interwar restrictions was that even the most junior soldier was trained to take the place of his superior. With some brilliant tacticians and military minds leading them, and supplied with good equipment, the German army of 1939 was a truly formidable opponent. Unleashed into Poland in September of that year, the skills learned were put to good use. Quick, decisive campaigns followed, one after the other, over the next 18 months. The average German soldier that crossed the Russian border in June 1941 was a well-trained, battle-experienced, and very capable man. Determined and professional, the German soldier of World War II would prove his ability again and again. April 1943 saw the German army in desperate need of recuperation after their recent victory at Kharkov. The Russian army was also in danger of outrunning its own extended supply lines. These two factors resulted in a period of relative quiet over the Kursk region. But as German intentions became clear, the Russians began an intensive program of defensive measures that were designed to trap and blunt the German armor. Thousands of anti-tank guns were built into defensive lines in great depth, and millions of anti-tank mines were laid. Both sides prepared for the coming clash throughout May and June 1943. Expectations were high. Both believed that they could achieve a decisive victory, but the commanders of both sides were apprehensive. They could sense the importance of the forthcoming clash, and could see how its outcome would affect the future course of the war.